Hi everyone, welcome back to the Hair Loss Show. Vikram, good to see you.
Nice to see you, Russell.
So today we're going to talk about what the patients bring us, is our yes. blood tests or saliva tests.
Absolutely.
And what we think about it.
So yeah, we get a lot of patients, don't we? They come and bless them, they're really gearing up to seeing us because they're worried about their hair loss. They've potentially had blood testing done elsewhere and they come in with a sort of folder full of their blood results. And I do the sort of needful, and we'll go through them just to make sure that there's nothing else and untoward. But I think that aside, if I look at other patients that come, you know, directly to me and I see in my practice, would we be recommending blood tests on them? No. For most people, I think the diagnosis that we're trying to make is a visual diagnosis. We can make it just looking at the patient's scalp. We can also make it when we look at it under magnification as well. And I think if there's anything untoward or we're uncertain, then we have to take a deeper dive and we have to take a biopsy and look at things at a cellular
yeah.
level.
No, I agree.
But the idea of look, do blood tests give us an idea of diagnosis? Probably not.
No.
Does the blood test influence how we're going to our treatment modalities and how we're going to prescribe? Probably not as well. Would you agree?
Yeah, I'd agree with that because usually what happens is they bring in a DHT blood test.
Yes.
Okay, because they know that or they've read that DHT is the problem hormone. So they want to come in and see whether they've got a high DHT. And almost invariably, they have a normal DHT.
Yes.
And one of the things that hair researchers worked out a long time ago is that most of the action in malapatent hair loss is happening inside the follicle, not yes. in the blood. And there's an estimate that maybe 70% of what happens in the follicle and maybe a little bit is brought by the blood. So patients having normal DHT is normal. We've done population samples
yes.
Up our yin yang on
so
this.
It's not
to know
about
that
the value in the blood, yeah. it's about the activity of the enzyme and the value at the
thyroid. If the thiamine alpha reductase is taking the testosterone and making the DHT, you've got the blood supply of DHT and you've got the follicle supply of DHT
yes.
adding together, and that's the problem. And so, you know, I find it quite useless in general to look at a blood test of DHT and make any inference from it. The same thing applies once they start treating, because if you put them on finasteride or something, we know their DHT level goes down and we know their testosterone level goes up. Mm. And that's the thing most patients don't understand, is that their testosterone level goes up. It's
yes.
an enzyme block, not a hormone block. Right, so the testosterone goes up 13%, DHT comes down about two-thirds. And so then they show me a blood test because they're on finasteride and, you know, are we on enough? You know, have we suppressed enough? And the answer is, I don't know.
Yes.
There's no empirical way to look at a DHT result after you've put them on finasteride and say that they're on enough finasteride.
Because
it's the result of what's happening in the scalp is the only way we can track it.
Correct. And so, I've seen commentary on that as well, where people have going, all right, I want to start therapy, I want to do my baseline blood so I know what my baseline DHT is, I'm going to start finasteride, I'm going to know what my treatment level of DHT is. And I say, well, that's fine, but that doesn't tell me what is happening at the level of the hair follicle.
Okay.
So it won't influence my decision on dosing, whether or not you're on too
Correct.
High, it's too low dose.
I think it's a rabbit hole.
Yes.
I actually think it's a rabbit hole that people chase down because they think they need some kind of empirical way to measure what's happening.
And I get that. I mean,
they come in and they say, oh, some days my hair looks good, other days it looks terrible. And I'm going, well, if you tell me that there's no consistent view, that means there's nothing happening.
Yes.
Right? If there are days where you feel it's not too bad and other days where you feel it's bad, there's moisture in the air, how long have you washed it, the angle of the light, how have you combed the hair, there's any number of things that can make it look different from day to day. But in male pattern hair loss, it doesn't change day to day.
And the other thing that we should also remember, right, is that hormonal levels vary over the course of a day.
Seven peaks.
Yes. So it really depends on when you chose to get the blood test, or when you actually got the
exactly.
blood test.
That's the hard thing.
You know, you could do two blood tests on the same individual an hour apart, and they could give you vastly different
yeah,
readings.
Exactly.
So it really doesn't tell you a lot.
So that's blood. What about saliva?
So saliva, I think, is another interesting thing. I think it's a sexy one. I know we've got a lot of colleagues that do it. I think it is available here in Australia. It is, but still the logistics of it, don't make it very easy because you have to do it and you have to send it over.
It has to be sent overseas
to
be assessed. It has to come back, and it's supposed to help direct your treatment. But the reality is, my problem with it is that it doesn't take account of what a dose response looks like.
Yes.
So if you say, well, you know, this test suggests that, you know, finasteride is going to work in about 50% of cases, and the minoxidil will work in about 70% of cases or 40% of cases. It's not telling you how much minoxidil you're taking or how much finasteride you're taking. And so I think that it, you know, it might be interesting, but I don't see how it really directly correlates with what we're going to do, because at the end of the day, it's the patient coming back in front of us and being examined. And it's the dermoscopy, you know, the using the microscope is the most important thing that we can do with the patients, is to look at the degree of miniaturization, look at the degree of hair loss, meaning loss of numbers in the region, and do that at magnification. That's what should direct our therapy.
So I have seen a few of the results, and I can't honestly say that the ones that I've seen, I would have looked at and gone, oh, well, this is going to change my management plan. Yeah. But one, I will recall one story of one person, and I asked them why they got it done. And they said, well, I'm really not keen on one particular therapy, so I wanted to see how effective the other form of therapy was. And I kind of got that, and I understood, I could see on one level the reasoning, but then on reflection, I was like, well, if that's the case, then you just try that other therapy and then see what happens.
Exactly.
Because if you don't want to take it,
we start with this one.
Yes, and then
and then we see how it goes. And if you're happy with the result, that's all we need to do. If you're not happy with the result, then you're going to have to reconsider whether
absolutely
we're going to go the
other way. You haven't closed the door again, but again, you can consider that. So,
that's not something that I have introduced into my practice
because I think I need
stricter guidelines as to how that's really going to help, rather than, you know, the idea that the technology sort of, you know, is sexy because you're using a bit of genetic testing. Well, genetic testing just tells you that you've got the susceptibility. It doesn't tell you how to manage it.
Yeah, no. So I think that's right. So I think from a testing perspective, right now the tests that are out there are not really influencing significantly diagnosis, and certainly not influencing significantly management plan. So I think where we're at is probably good just from a diagnosis.
So, I mean, apart from the fact they're expensive, and I don't think they really are going to be particularly helpful, so I don't recommend them.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Same here. Mm. All right. I hope you found that useful on testing. Again, please remember to like and subscribe to the channel. Thank you again for watching, and we'll see you on the next episode.
Thanks, everyone.